He is risen. Yes, He has. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Last Sunday, Palm Sunday, celebrated throughout the world as the day that Jesus came riding into Jerusalem in the triumphant entry, and the inhabitants of Jerusalem were laying palm branches down, and they were putting their cloaks and blankets down, and Christ was riding in on the fold of a donkey, and they were crying, "Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." Unfortunately, last Sunday in Egypt, it was not a day of triumph, it was a day of tragedy. It was not a day of blessing, it was a day of brokenness, especially in two churches. In Egypt, two Christian churches were attacked, killing 44 people. It was the deadliest day of violence in Egypt in decades. ISIS has claimed responsibility for both bombings. The first attack was in the northern city of Tanta, St. George's Church. The explosion killed 27 and injured 78 others. The explosive device was planted under a seat in the main hall of prayer, close to the altar. Shortly afterward, at St. Mark's Cathedral in Alexandria, Egypt, 16 people were killed and 41 were wounded as a suicide bomber attacked. What you may not know is that when the second suicide bomber neared St. Mark's Cathedral, a security officer recognized something was amiss, and the security officer literally ran and tried to hug the bomber as the explosion happened. Think about that. 16 people died, 41 were wounded, but in my mind, I wonder how many would have died and how many would have been wounded had this security guard not sacrificed his life and his body as a human shield to take a large impact of that explosion as that bomb literally spread out. Here's one man who gave his life to save many. He couldn't save them all, but he saved many. But this morning we're going to talk about a man, a God-man named Jesus, who doesn't let one get away, who has provided salvation, security, and protection for all. For anyone, for any man or any woman or any student or any child who would say, "Jesus, I want you," Christ will save you. In humans' best efforts, we do the best we can, but we can't shield everybody. The blood of Christ, the resurrected Savior from the dead, can shield everybody from the guilt and shame of sin, and heaven can be ours. That's what we want to talk about on Easter Sunday morning here at Thompson Station Church. If you have your hard copy of God's Word, or if you have your electronic copy, would you go to the book of John? This morning we'll conclude a series of messages entitled, "Who is Jesus?" And today's message, as we celebrate Easter Sunday, the message is entitled, "Jesus is my Lord and my God." We'll come to that at the end of the message, where John, in the book of John, records that Thomas, known as the doubter, makes a confession, "My Lord and my God." Would you pray with me? Father, thank you that the Spirit of the living God is in this place. Thank you that this weekend we are sensing and experiencing and knowing the power of the resurrected Savior. Thank you for all of these who have come to hear your word and to celebrate the living Christ. So, Lord, I pray right now that you would give me your words, and may my mind and mouth be obedient in sync with your heart, God, and speak only what pleases you. Help me, Holy Spirit. Thank you for your presence. Fill me now. I yield completely to you. In Jesus' name, amen. I want us to walk through the last moments of the life of Christ and through his death and through his resurrection all in the next 25 minutes, if you will. And I want us to start in John chapter 19, verse 1. And I want us to look together at the humiliation of our Savior, the humiliation of the Son of the living God. John 19, 1. Pilate then took Jesus and scourged him. And the soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put upon his head and put a purple robe on him. And they began to come up to him and say, "Hail, King of the Jews." And they all slapped him or hit him in the face. The humiliation. Can you imagine that God's Son, Creator of the heaven and the earth, endured this kind of humiliation for us? It involved a scourging. This scourging in verse 1, they scourged him. You've heard it said the kind of whip the Roman soldiers would use is a cat of nine tails, nine strands of leather tied in knots, and in the end of every strand was a chip of bone or a sharp metallic piece that would literally shred the flesh of a human as that stripe was gone across the back. Unimaginable that God Himself would allow Himself to experience that on our behalf. Horrific, and He endured that for us. The crown of thorns upon His head. Verse 2, they twisted a vine of thorns into a crown and they put it upon his head. Jesus was being mocked to the highest degree. Instead of a king's golden crown encrusted with jewels, they took this vine of thorns and put it into a mock crown and they gave it to a man they perceived to be a make-believe king. And they laughed and they hit him. The purple robe, verse 2. And they clothed him with a purple robe. You know that the color purple, especially in the day of Christ, was the color of royalty. Where the crown of thorns was a mock of kingship, the purple robe was an emblem of mock royalty. Visualize the humiliation. The Creator of the heavens and the earth, unimaginable that God would descend from heaven, clothe Himself in flesh, live a perfect sinless life, only helping and encouraging and blessing. And yet He would subject Himself to the humiliation of this kind of treatment. And He would do it for us. Don't take that lightly, that God humbled Himself. Philippians chapter 2 says He humbled Himself and became the form of a man. He suffered the death, even the death of the cross. For us. That's the kind of love that God has for us. His Son, Jesus, would allow Himself to be humiliated on our behalf. Let's move quickly from that humiliation scene. And there, when Pilate washed his hands because he was a coward and he chose politics over what was right, and he was afraid, and so he turned him over. Knowing he was innocent, Pilate the coward let him go. Finally, Pilate, verse 16 says, he handed him over to them to be crucified. I want us to see the crucifixion. I've also stated that it is the execution of our Savior. The crucifixion, the execution. Carrying his own cross, verse 17 says, he went out to the place of the skull, which in Aramaic is called Golgotha. Here they crucified him with two others, one on the right and one on the left, Christ in the middle. Now every Easter and the Sundays prior to Easter, pastor has to contemplate in his mind what he will and what he won't say in a service that will have all kinds of ages of children and teens and adults and all kinds of folks from different backgrounds. And what do you say about the crucifixion? I dare not describe the truth of the horror of the cross and the death on the cross. I wouldn't do that in this setting. But should you be interested, all you have to do is Google it. It is not a pretty sight. Let me just say this. The Roman soldiers designed the death that was the most cruel and inhumane death, that it prolonged life over and over and over so that the victim would relive the agony over and over. And you literally die of suffocation. I don't want to go any more with that. What I'd like to look at is three of the last words of Christ. Many of you who have been reared in church are familiar. There are seven last words, but I just want to touch three when we talk about this crucifixion scene with Christ hanging on the cross and what He says from the cross. The last words of any person who is dying are very important. The last words are powerful and poignant of any person, but none are more powerful than the last words of God Himself as He dies on the cross on our behalf. So let's just look at three. Time won't permit seven, but let's look at three. The first, if you would, flip over in your hard copy or your electronic copy, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. If you're in John, go back one book to Luke 23, please. Luke 23, 33. And I want us to see a word of forgiveness. Luke 23, 33. When they came to the place called the Skull, there they crucified Him along with the criminals, one on His right, the other on His left. Verse 34, here it is. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing." Father, forgive them, they do not know what they're doing. Now, the first and the last sayings of Jesus from the cross begin with Father. There's a dialogue. There's an intentional statement, Father. To me, it reminds us that Jesus' death on the cross and the redemption story of humanity started in the heart of God. It reminds us that this salvation that Jesus and God the Father provide, they were working it out from the beginning. This wasn't some random act that they made up as they went. God didn't look down at humanity and say, "Oh, Jesus, look at those guys. I had no idea they want to mess up. What are we going to do?" He didn't make up this plan. Before God ever created Adam and Eve, knowing in advance they would sin, God already knew His plan of redemption, and Jesus had already subjected Himself to the humiliation, to the crucifixion, to the execution. He said, "God, I'll do it." Even before they made all of this, Jesus said, "I'll do it." Father, the partnership of God the Father and God the Son always had the intentional redemption of humanity in their hearts for us. As Jesus was nailed to that cross, and as that mallet came down on that spike the size of a railroad spike and drove through the wrist of Christ, Jesus says this, not curses but blessings. He says, "Father, forgive them, they don't know what they're doing." And He expressed this compassion, this forgiveness toward the Roman soldiers as they nailed Him to the cross. He expressed this compassion, this forgiveness toward the religious leaders, the Jewish leaders who moved through the crowd, instigating them to call for Barabbas' release instead of Jesus' release, when Pilate knew that Barabbas was guilty and Jesus was innocent. And this forgiveness, this tone of compassion and forgiveness was to all those who said, "Barabbas, Barabbas, crucify, crucify Him." And just a week earlier, they were saying, "Hosanna, Hosanna." This is a word of forgiveness to all those at that scene and all those who did that torturous, murderous act to Jesus. But I think more importantly this morning, don't forget this. Would you lean in with me and listen? And down through 2,000 years, I can hear this from the cross. "Father, forgive Tom. Father, forgive Andrea. Father, forgive Bill. Father, forgive Susan." Why do you say that, Tom? Because is it not true that what really put Jesus on the cross wasn't any Jewish leader? What really nailed Jesus to the cross was not really any Roman soldier, but what really nailed Jesus to the cross was Tom's sin. My sin and yours, that's what put Christ on the cross. Our wrongdoing, our hard hearts, our calloused hearts, our selfish hearts nailed Christ to the cross. And so down through the epochs and ages, I can hear Jesus saying, "Father, forgive Tom, because I love him and I want to save him and I want to die for him." Would you take a second and listen? If you've forgotten, I want to remind you, I think Jesus is calling your name from Calvary's cross and saying, "Father, I love him. I love her. They're mine. They've got my forgiveness." You're included in that. Those of you who are watching by live stream, you're included. Jesus says, "I love you and I forgive you." A word of forgiveness. There's a second word I want us to look at as Jesus hangs suspended between heaven and earth, naked and exposed to the world, dying a death he didn't deserve, saving those who certainly don't deserve it. And he gives a word of salvation also found in Luke 23. Move to verse 39 if you have your Bibles. One of the criminals hurled insults at Jesus. "Aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God? Since you and I are under the same sentence, we're punished justly. We're getting what our deeds deserve, but this man is innocent. He's done nothing wrong." And verse 42, this second criminal says, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Don't forget me when all this transpires." And verse 43, Jesus answered, "I tell you the truth. Today you will be with me in paradise." Today you'll be with me in paradise. This word for heaven, Jesus used it only once. It's the same word in the Greek that John and Paul both used to refer to heaven. But as you think about this word, this sentence, this word from Jesus, a word of salvation, and he says it to this criminal who says, "Remember me. I want to be there. I want whatever you have. I need whatever you have." That's what he's saying as that criminal pushes up trying to get a breath, and he speaks to Christ, and Jesus said, "Today." Yeah, we both know today you'll die, but I want to tell you, it's not over when you die. You'll be with me in paradise. In that moment, even in the agony of his physical body, can't you just feel and sense a tranquility, a peace, a calm that comes over his mind and his spirit? "This body will die, but my soul will live on with Jesus." Somehow peace prevailed over that criminal. In this one phrase, "Today you'll be with me in paradise," Jesus promises the soul never dies. And he promises that we are immediately aware of our existence in another life after this life ceases. In this simple statement to a dying criminal, Christ gives all of us hope for eternity and for heaven. This is not it. This is not all there is. But I would be remiss if I didn't tell you clearly and accurately that yes, the soul never dies and we all live for eternity. There are more than just one place that your soul can spend eternity. With Christ, like this criminal, "Lord Jesus, I want you." This criminal is in heaven. But only those who will claim Christ are there. There's another place of separation away from God, away from heaven, away from Jesus, and it's called hell. And God looks down at humanity with Christ in between, and Christ on the cross is symbolically lifting a hand to God and a hand to man, and he's bringing imperfection to perfection, and he's joining the two by his shed blood and his forgiveness. And the only way you and I can miss hell and make heaven is through Christ and through Calvary. That's it. I would be wrong if I didn't tell you the truth. Today, do not let this day pass. Do not let this moment pass if you're not sure that Christ is your Savior. Make him your Savior today. Here's a third word I'd share from John 19, back in the book of John, verse 30. It is a word of victory. A word of victory. Verse 30, Jesus, when he had received the sour wine, Jesus said, "It is finished." He bowed his head and he gave up his spirit. It is finished. Tom, what is finished? Your redemption, my redemption, it's finished. The work is done. Nothing else needs be done, yet Christ died and shed his blood for us. Verse 4 of John 17, Jesus says to God the Father, "I have finished the work which you gave me to do." It is finished. Through his horrible and tragic death, Jesus defeated all that would hold us back from God. He defeated death and hell and sin and the grave and gave us an open path through the forgiveness of our sin by his shed blood. The Greek word, one word that translated, "it is finished," the Greek word you may be familiar is tetelestai. It means it is accomplished. It is paid in full. It was the same Greek word that was put on taxes. The Romans, who ruled the earth for 1,000 years, promised you two or three things when they came and conquered you. They promised you justice. They would give justice. They would punish the wrong and free the innocent. They promised you good roads. They promised you protection with their armies. And then you had to give them two things: submission to their dictatorship, Caesar, and submission through taxes. You gave them taxes and allegiance to the dictator, and they gave you roads and justice and protection. That's how it worked for 1,000 years. And when people paid taxes to Rome, this word, tetelestai, well, during that season, it was stamped on the parchment, on the papyrus, paid in full. Nothing else has to be given for this. That's what Jesus did. He paid our price in full. You can't work for it. You can't earn it. You just receive it, the free gift of eternal life. Would you look at that phrase one more time with me? It is finished. It's right there in John 19:30. Say it with me. It is finished. Say it one more time, please. Sometimes when you read the Bible, it's good to notice what is not said as well as what is said. What is not said is this: Jesus didn't say, "I am finished." He said, "It is finished." There's a world of difference in "I am finished" and "it is finished." Redemption is finished. The price has been paid. The victory's been won. But Jesus was just getting started. The good stuff happened 3 days later. That was Good Friday. It's Friday, but Sunday's coming. And because he came up from that grave on Easter Sunday, we live because he lives. Jesus is just getting started in the hearts of humanity. People all over the world, even still 2,000 years later, are coming to Christ, receiving forgiveness, being healed in body, spirit, soul, and family. God is still at work. God still reigns. He hasn't slowed down. He hasn't backed up. He hasn't let up. God is still on his throne, and Christ is still drawing people to himself. He's not even close to being finished. And importantly, ladies and gentlemen, he's not finished in you and he's not finished with you. He's just getting started. The mere fact that you're sitting in the house of God today is a bold statement that you're interested in the things of God. And let me tell you, as much as you think you're interested in God, he's a million times more interested in you. And he's not finished with you. He's just getting started. My friend and many of yours, Alan Walker, his body was beaten and broken. His life was stolen by the cruel disease of cancer. He died March 10th of this year. Alan and his precious wife, Norma, faithful servants for many years at Thompson Station. A couple of weeks before Alan died, I visited with he and Norma on several occasions, but on one particular occasion, Alan made a statement, and it was so powerful and so full of strength. I immediately got my phone and went to the notes, and I wrote it down, and I want to share just a short quote from Alan Walker, whose life was stolen by cancer about 6 weeks ago. Alan said this, and I quote, "I am blessed with this cancer. I just want people to see my faith and trust the Lord. I'm going to a better place when this life is over. I am blessed with this cancer." You got that? Not "I'm cursed with this cancer." Not "I hate this cancer." "I'm blessed with this cancer. I just want people to see my faith, to see Jesus in me, and trust in my Lord." Just like Alan said, "I am blessed with this cancer." The Lord Jesus says, "I am blessed with this cross, because by me being on this cross, they can spend eternity in heaven. I'm blessed with this cross so that we can be in a better place." The resurrection. Turn your Bibles or go electronically to John 20, the resurrection. Mary goes to the tomb in the first of John 20. It's empty. She goes back and tells the disciples, "Peter and John, come." And we find ourselves in verse 9. Verse 9 says, these disciples did not understand from Scripture. They didn't understand the prophecies. They didn't even catch it when Jesus said, like Jonah's in the belly of the big fish, I'll be in the belly of the earth. They still didn't get it. Verse 9 says, they didn't understand he had to rise from the dead. Not yet. And then they went home, it says, because he was gone. That's what verse 10 says. The disciples went back to their nets. They went back fishing. But somebody didn't go home. Look at verse 11. John 20, Mary stood outside the tomb crying. She wept. She bent over and looked into the tomb. She saw the angels. They asked, why are you crying? Verse 13, they've taken away my Lord. I don't know where he is. At that point in verse 14, she turns. She sees Jesus, but she didn't know it was Jesus. Verse 15, woman, why are you crying? Who is it you're looking for? Mary, thinking that Jesus, who she didn't recognize, is the gardener, she says, sir, have you carried him away? Tell me where you put him. I'll go get him. Then Jesus says, Mary. He speaks her name, Mary. She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, Rabboni, teacher, mentor. Jesus appeared to Mary, and there was an encounter. There was an encounter. That glorious Easter morning, it was an event in Mary Magdalene's life. Sure, it was a factual event, but it was an amazing Resurrection Day experience. It was an encounter for Mary. I would to God, I would plead, I would beg that today would not be an event for any of us in this room. That it would be an encounter and an experience with the living Christ, that I would leave here never to be the same again, that I'll never be the same again because I've encountered Christ alive and he's alive in me. Have you experienced Jesus? Have you had a life-changing, eternity-changing encounter with Christ? That's the reason for Easter. The reason for Easter is not all the beautiful elements that we see with our physical eyes and the nice clothes and the flowers and the fun that we have. And those are all fine, but those are external trappings of what we're talking about. We're talking about an internal encounter with the living Lord Jesus. Like each of us, like Mary, each of us must wipe the tears from our eyes and shake the confusion from our heads, break open the hardness, if we need to, of our hearts, and experience the living Savior. It's an encounter. Have an encounter with Christ today, I beg you. My last thought is where I started. A confession. The confession. Jesus had appeared to the disciples, but Thomas was not with them in verse 19 to 23. Some people see Thomas as a doubter and a skeptic. I think sometimes we're too hard on Thomas. We often forget that in John chapter 11, when Jesus delays going back to Bethany to see the sisters Mary and Martha, the brother Lazarus, he lets Lazarus die so that he might raise him from the dead and bring glory to the Father. But he says, when he decides to go back, the disciples try to talk him out. Say, don't go back to Bethany. It's right near Jerusalem. The Jews tried to kill you there. It wasn't Peter who spoke up. Let me tell you who it was. It was Thomas. And Thomas looks at the disciples and says, hey, guys, let's go back with him that we might die with him. It was Thomas who said, let's go die with him, all of us together. If he's going to die, we're going to die. Doesn't sound like a coward. Doesn't sound like a person of weakness and character. Sounds like a man of strength. And you say, well, what about he didn't really believe the others? Everybody comes to faith from a different angle. And what this reminds me of is we're not all just alike. And so be sure that we're never down on somebody who has some questions about what we've experienced, okay? Don't be pointing your finger in judgment to them. It's just a reminder that everybody doesn't come to the Lord in the same way, from the same angle. It takes different experiences, different exposures, different conversations, different understandings. And Thomas needed a little bit more, and that's okay. And if you're there sitting in this worship center or watching via the internet, it's okay to have some questions. Nobody's judging you for that. What happens when Jesus comes? Let's look. Verse 24, John 20. Now Thomas, one of the 12, was not with the disciples. He said, unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger in the nails where and put my hand in his side, I will not believe. A week later, verse 26, John 20, the disciples were in the house again. Thomas was there. The doors were locked And yet Jesus came and stood in the midst and said, "Peace be with you." And then nobody said a word. And look at 27. Jesus immediately goes to the one who wasn't there the first time, initiates the conversation, and says, "Thomas, put your finger here in my wrist. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. You don't have to doubt. Believe." Let me tell you what Jesus didn't do. "Thomas, I can't believe you, low-life, hard-headed, hard-hearted skunk of a man. Never going to believe I did all this for you. You're just wicked." Jesus didn't do that. Just like a few weeks ago we talked about Jesus and Zacchaeus. Jesus didn't go, "Zacchaeus, you little punk, come down from that tree. I'm going to your house. I doubt if I can save you, but I'll do my best. You're too far gone." Jesus didn't do that. What did he do? He appeared in that room with all those disciples, and now Thomas is there, and this is what he said. He said, "Thomas, it's okay. I love you. I did die for you, but I'm not dead now. Come on, friend. We're in this together. Put your hand right there. Here it is. Put your finger right there. It's okay. Just believe. Man, if you've had doubts, it's okay. But Jesus says, reach out and touch me today. Jesus says, come on and know me today. I love you and I died for you. Come be with me today." My wife and I came to Thompson Station some 28 years ago. And we were suffering with infertility. We were not able to get pregnant. We were paying multiple thousands of dollars and doing all the treatments. And it's better, the treatment's better today than it was even back then, some 30 years ago almost. We were working on it for several years. We went down to the doctors and did all the shots and everything, and she had the surgery, and she had polycystic ovaries. And thank goodness for modern medicine, thank the Lord, we were able to have a daughter, and then a second daughter, and then a son, and then I put a stop to that. Prior to all those kids, like many people do, we had a pet, and and you love your pets. There's nothing wrong with that. We had a shepherd collie mix. It was a little puppy. It was a dog that we named Rabbi. And at seminary, we would call our buddies that we studied with Rabbi. It was just kind of a joke, the learned one or the teacher or the mentor. And so we would just kind of facetiously, sarcastically say Rabbi to each other. And so I named my dog to remember my friends. I don't know what that means. So Rabbi would go everywhere with me. We lived on Clayton Arnold Road at the corner of Kreitz and Clayton Arnold, a little white farmhouse that's still there. If you come off of 31, well, you can't right now, but when the construction's not there, you can come off 31 and come down Kreitz Lane. First road on your right is Clayton Arnold. We lived right in that corner. You pass Canterbury, and then Clayton Arnold's on the right, and then you go up the hill, and a little bit later on the left is Bridgemore. Between those two, on the left-hand side, the northern side of Kreitz Lane, there was a farm. A man named Bell Beatty farmed it. Not Bill, but Bell, B-E-L-L. Farmed it for the owners of the land, and there was a rock entrance to his long driveway that was like a quarter mile back to his barn. I'd go help him from time to time. You know, when you have a whopping attendance of like 12, you got a little free time on your hands. And so I would farm with him. If you've ever raked millet, I've raked millet before, and I helped Bell Beatty rake millet, and it's so dusty it messes up your sinuses. Well, that day I had my dog where Rabbi went everywhere with me, and we went up to see Bell, and Bell's Ford tractor, his blue Ford tractor, was stuck on the side of the road on Kreitz, and I pulled up behind him. He said, "I don't know why it won't start. Let's go get and pull it back to the barn with my other tractor." So he jumped in the car with me, and Rabbi's out of the vehicle running around the fields. We go all the way back to his barn, and I'm driving this Alice Chalmers tractor. I mean, it's several tons. It's got to be 7 feet off the ground, and I'm driving up his long gravel driveway, and Bell's standing on the lifts above the PTO on the back of the tractor. Those of you a little bit familiar with tractors will know where that is, and he's standing holding on, and I'm driving. We get to the head of his driveway with Kreitz there, big cedar trees with rock wall, and I can't really see out, so I stop at the head of the driveway. There's a little other little tenant house long been gone across the road, and right when I was pulling out, Rabbi, my dog came up from the right, and the tenant house across the road, a dog chased my dog and ran right under my front wheel of this huge tractor, and I ran over my dog. I knew I ran over because I felt the tractor go up, but I had to pull it on up a couple of few yards up behind the Ford tractor, and I stopped. I put it in gear, got off, and ran back. And Rabbi had run through those rock entrance and back into the field about 30 yards and was laying down. When I got there to Rabbi, dog was laid flat out in grass about that tall. It was in the spring, early summer. And I got down on my knees over that dog, and I bent down and I listened. I could tell there was no breathing, but I listened, and I heard a faint heartbeat. I said, this dog's still alive. I was 25, and I'd had 10 years of water safety instruction. I was an advanced savings lifeguard with the American Red Cross, a water safety instructor. I taught lifeguarding. I took my hands, and I cupped that dog's mouth and put a tongue in, and I did mouth-to-nose resuscitation on that dog, trying to bring life back to that dog. We loved that dog. I knew that dog was in terrible shape, and I tried to resuscitate that dog. When I gave the first breaths, as you do in CPR, I heard the blood gurgling in the lungs, which was indication the ribs had been broken, punctured the lungs, and there was no life for that dog. I laid the dog's head in my lap, and within 30 seconds, that faint heartbeat stopped, and that dog lay motionless and without life in my lap, and I knew I was going to have to carry that dog home and tell my wife that I'd run over our dog, and my heart was breaking. In that moment, I know that it wouldn't be the right thing, but if in that moment I had the power to give life to just one creature on planet Earth, rather than getting in my car and going to the sickest child at Vanderbilt Clinic, I probably wouldn't have done that. I probably would have given life to that dog in that moment as I felt that hurt in my heart and the hurt I knew my wife would feel. But here's the problem is I don't have the power of life in my hands or in my heart. As much as I'd like to, I don't have that power. But I'll tell you who does. The one who defeated death, hell, and the grave, the Lord Jesus, has the power of life, both eternal and abundant. And he's calling out from the cross today down through the ages, and he's saying, come to me, all you are weary and heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. He's saying, I love you. It's okay if you've got some doubts. Put your hand right here. I love you. And you know what he's calling from all of us? He wants the same response that Thomas gave. My Lord and my God. My Lord and my God. Would you bow your heads all over this room? If you're not sure that heaven will be your home and you're not sure that Jesus is your Savior, maybe as a 4 or 5-year-old you did something but you can't even remember it, but you're not confident in that, today is the day to be confident. Like Mary had an encounter, like Thomas had an encounter, you need to have an encounter with Jesus. Pilate made a choice. He chose poorly. The Jewish leaders had a choice. They chose poorly. Would you choose Jesus today? If you want to accept Christ, you pray this prayer. Jesus, come into my heart. Forgive my sins. I know that I'm a sinner. I've done wrong. I know you died on that cross and bled for me. Thank you for your sacrificial death and your shed blood. Thank you for defeating death and coming out of that grave on Easter for me so that I might have life. I receive you, Jesus, as Lord and Savior. And I make my confession as Thomas made it. My Lord and my God, Jesus, save me. Take me to heaven when I die. Be my guide, my best friend, my boss, all of my living days. And take me to heaven when I die. I love you, Jesus. Would you pray that prayer? Did you pray that prayer?